another episode of the Do Big podcast. And today we have something and a topic which is really interesting for all of us. You know, we all struggle with the entire customer experience journey, whether it is from the onboarding perspective to all the way having onboarded people to managing it after, you know, a person has become our customers and to make sure that they remain as loyal customers with us. And that is always, always a challenge for all of us. Today, we have with us Rajashree Jadhav, Vice President, Digital Acquisition and Onboarding, 5paisa Capital Limited. Rajashree Jadhav, if you have interacted with her, you will realize is an extremely effective professional when it comes to customer experience, operations, digital acquisition, customer satisfaction, vendor management, CRM management. And I say this with confidence because she has 25 plus years of experience doing all of this. She specialized in creating and implementing innovative solutions in business process re-engineering, requirements and systems analysis to increase efficiency, customer retention, and customer satisfaction levels. Over the years, she has managed large teams of 400 plus people, and she has extensive expertise in formulating processes, analyzing, documenting, validating, and managing system requirements. If I had to manage a 400-member team, I would definitely know how difficult the task is. And without much ado, I'm going to jump into my conversation with Rajashree Jadhav because I know each one of you has so much to learn from her. Welcome, Rajashree. It is so nice to have you on the Do Big podcast.
Thank you so much, Sheetal, for getting me here. Really excited to share my experience with all the listeners.
That's fantastic, Rajashree. As you are aware, our listeners are typically MSMEs and, you know, they are all very keen to learn new things that are happening, which may have been implemented by large companies, but also understanding them from that perspective of how they can implement these things within their own organizations. And so let me kind of start off with our first question for you. And my first question to you really is that, you know, you've done so much around customer experience, but how would you define customer experience in the digital world? And how does that differ from customer experience when you think of it from the traditional offline world, if I may call it that?
Digital customer experience is nothing but the experience that the customer has with the company or the organization on digital platforms. Now, digital platforms could be your site, the app, social media to a large extent, chatbots, etc. Now, when we compare this to what the customer experience was in traditional, there are many physical aspects that come into play when it comes to the traditional customer experience. You know, when you walk into a store or when you walk into a shop to buy anything, what you actually evaluate is what is the wait time, what is the ease of finding the items, how is the packaging, how are the payment methods, how long is the queue, is the staff neat and clean. So all those aspects come into play when you actually walk into a store or a shop to buy something. That is how your customer experience is getting built. When it comes to the digital platforms, what is that gets measured or how does the customer experience come into play over there is what is the load time for the pages to load? What is the refresh time? How easy is it to navigate or search on the site or the app? It could be other things like how secured is the site or app? So customer experience is definitely different when it comes to digital compared to a traditional. So it's a part of the overall customer experience. Okay. So there are brands like who would be involved into both of them. Like if I talk about lifestyle, if I talk about Westside, I mean, you know, those brands. So they are into both these spaces, right? They do have their own app. So when it comes to them, they will have both these aspects playing for them, both these customer experiences that they'll have to measure on, but could be in isolation also.
And so would this be true whether it is for shopping or for whether I'm investing in money or something else, or would it differ if I was in different categories or different spaces?
See, when it comes to investment, when it is digital, the person is not sitting in front of you convincing how good or bad the product is, right? So whatever information that is available on the site or whatever information is available on the app has to be convincing enough that the user can directly make a decision and is not dependent on someone to come and explain it to him. Whereas on a physical world, if you're looking into, there is someone who's sitting there trying to convince you, showing the product to you, probably, you know, or maybe showing a plan to you, you know, has a direct contact with the user where he's in the position to convince the user or the buyer, which is not the case in a digital world.
When you think about consumer expectations and, you know, and you talk about technology, both are constantly evolving. Because what happens with consumers is I experience something good in a completely different space, and then that becomes the benchmark across board, right? And all of us have faced it. So we were all okay with packages reaching a little late, a little early, in a bad place, in a bad way. But Amazon came and redefined the expectation. Now that becomes kind of your benchmark, right? So same is the case with technology, right? I remember many, many years ago, when Kingfisher Airlines was still there, you know, they had started doing the scanning and they were printing your boarding cards when you were standing in queue. And then everybody started fretting and saying, why is it that the other airlines are not doing that? And they kind of redefined what the consumer's expectations are. And so customer expectation is changing. Technology is constantly evolving. How do you think MSMEs can stay agile and kind of, you know, adapt to their customers' experience strategies to keep pace with these changes?
The key to this agility is to be customer-centric. You know, if you keep customer in the center of everything, then everything falls in place. Instead of making products or designing products in silos, one has to go back to the customer to understand what is his expectations with you. What are his expectations with the brand or with the company or with the product? Okay, keep collecting these feedbacks. Keep listening to the customers. Keep listening to their complaints also. Only then you will be able to develop something which is exactly what the customer wants. So what you have to first do is create a lot of ways through which the customer can reach out to you in the first place. Mm. So if there is a feedback that the customer has to give you, there could be a message probably that could go out. It could be post completing a transaction on the site. It could be through a voice call, seaside service. So there are many, many things that you can do to collect these feedbacks. Now, once these feedbacks have come to you, it is really, really important. How do you actually use them? Okay. How do you actually listen to them, organize them in a way that it is actually delivering to the customer's expectation? Okay. Once you have done it, you know, it doesn't even stop there. You know, once you've done those changes, you also have to go back to the customer, let them know that basis your requirement, basis your expectation, basis your voice, we have done these changes. Okay. So that the user also feels that, okay, so his feedback, his voice was heard. Okay. See, customer is the best brand for you. I mean, he's the best influencer for you when it comes to, you know, usability. If you do that, he also reaches out to another 10 people saying that, okay, you know, I did this and they've changed this product because of me. You have to go out on the social media to advertise these things also. Not necessarily saying that this customer suggested it, but just to say that, okay, this was the voice of our customers and we have made changes to the product or to the, or to the site or to the app, basis customer feedback, and this is out for you to use. And we still are open to it, you know, to take suggestions and feedback. If we keep doing this, I don't think there's anything different that needs to be done there.
Okay.
But you have to keep doing it regularly. It cannot be a one-time
activity. And it's interesting because what you're saying is use the digital tools that are available to you to make sure that you're constantly listening to what the consumer has to say. You know, it's quite fascinating because I think that's one of the biggest flaws that I see in a lot of systems where you put in a message, you complain, and nothing moves. And then you as a customer gets completely frustrated. I always tell people that a customer who gives you negative feedback is a good customer to have because at least the customer's involved, right? The indifferent ones wouldn't be bothered. They won't even tell you anything. And they'll just walk away and they'll become bad ambassadors for you. But the ones who complain, you should listen to.
90 to 95% of the customers who actually leave, they don't even complain to you.
Correct.
Okay, so they don't even give you the opportunity to do anything. So that's big that number is.
And that's exactly what I mean. Because as a researcher, I know that when somebody actually complains to you, it's because they feel for the brand and they have some emotional connect still with the brand. And when the brand doesn't listen to that, they are even more disappointed. And therefore, they become actively the bad ambassadors for the brand. The indifferent ones don't do anything, but don't even necessarily badmouth you. The involved ones are the ones you lose and do a lot of damage to brand image and to brand reputation. So it's quite fascinating. I didn't expect the number to be a 90%. I did expect it to be a 70 plus, but a 90 is really, really high on that front. When you're talking about experience and customer experience, and how does one A, define KPIs, and B, then measure KPIs when you think about focusing on, if you want to kind of measure the success of your digital customer experience initiatives? So different initiatives, different KPIs and measures, or how does it work?
See, overall, the key things that when I was a part of customer service, the things that I was looking at was, first is my customer satisfaction score. What it does is it tells me that how satisfied your customers are with you. Okay, are with you when I'm saying it, the brand with the company. Okay. The second most important KPI would be the NPS, so which is your net promoter score. Okay, it actually tells you how willing is the customer to recommend you to someone. And these NPS can be done at different transaction levels also. Small things like if a customer walks into an ATM to withdraw cash, a small thing like, he would have called up the call center for something. So these things can be measured at a transaction level. And then this question that, okay, basis this experience, would you recommend us to someone? And this is a very, very good tool to test a new product or a service also. If you ever would want to, launch and then test it, I think it's a very, very good tool to do that. The third is that, what is your first response time? Okay. When I'm saying a response time, it's not necessarily a resolution time. Response time is that as soon as the customer is reaching out to you for any query or complaint, how quickly can you go back to him and say that, okay, fine, we've heard you. Give us some time to resolve and come back to you. Okay. At least do that so that he knows that, okay, there is someone who's looking into my query or complaint and they would come back to me. So that is also very, very important, because then the customer is all the time anxious, saying that, pata nahi mera mail pahuncha ke nahi pahuncha, are they working on it or not? And there are a lot of customers who interact through chatbots, and you have your self-service platforms where you can just type in and send in your query. So you don't even know what has happened after that, unless you have a ticket that gets generated over there. So that's an important thing. The other thing is that once you are measuring on a first response rate, what is then equally important is to look into the average resolution time also. Okay, you have told the customer that, okay, yes, I've heard, but that doesn't mean that, there is no resolution time that you should be looking into. For every query, there has to be a defined TAT. When I say TAT, it's a turnaround time, of resolution. So what is that TAT? Is something that you can define as a company. You can say that, okay, for small things like password, you can do it instantly. For something like where an ATM card needs to be dispatched, it will take 3 working days. So something like that. But when you're actually doing that, also see to it that you're adhering to those TATs. Okay. How many cases are such where it is breaching the TAT that has been committed to the customer? So that's a very, very important tool to look, KPI to look into. Then lastly, it is the customer churn or the retention rate. Okay. How many customers are leaving you versus what you've acquired? And what is the retention? Now there could, as I mentioned earlier also, there are many customers who don't even give you the opportunity and they just walk out. You would not even know that they've started investing through someone else or trading through someone else. You not even know that. Are there any early signals? Look into those trends. So you should be looking into that. The second is that if the customer is calling you up or writing to you saying that, okay, I want to close my account, okay, how can you ensure that the retention there is really, really high to the extent that the customer doesn't leave you? That is an important KPI to look into. That out of 100 customers who are calling you, one, how much was your retention rate? And what were the top issues because of which they were leaving you? And then work backwards and ensure that those issues are closed in a way that you don't have more customers who come in with the same issue or with the same concern.
That actually leads me to a very interesting question. Typically, large organizations at least fall trap to this, where people are working in silos. So customer satisfaction is somebody's job. It's not necessarily another person's job, right? And what tends to happen as a result of which is turnaround times, response times, all of that start getting affected to a large extent. How can MSMEs kind of work around that? Because having worked in large organizations, I know for a fact that, especially when you talked about things like CSAT scores or first response time. Now, the first response time is very quick because it may be an automated email or it may be an automated piece, right? But the next one, which is the resolution time, because it is dependent on somebody else and not necessarily on the customer, you know, management team or whatever, starts to fall through the cracks. So what is it that MSMEs can do to make sure that they stay, because agility is on their side. So what can they do to make sure that that happens?
See, I would not say that it is difficult or easy in a large organization versus to an MSME. It is how, what your intent is. If the intent is correct, you know, if we know that as a company or as a group, we have to ensure that the customers stay with us, customers continue to be with us. If that is the kind of approach, it is easy to work on it, because then what you do is that as a group, you come together. So in one of the companies that I was working earlier, we had created something like a service quality group. Now, what does this group do is it assigns responsibility or accountability on the set of issues that are there. And every issue or a pain point has a pod in itself. So this pod would have people from the product, it would have people from technology, it would have people from customer service, and so on. So depending on what the issue is. Now, when you create a pod, so each person there knows that what is their role into solving this. Okay. If you keep creating those pods and assign accountability there, I don't think it is difficult to manage the tax. And senior management, you know, it's a bigger role that senior management has to play into this, saying that, okay, how is it possible that 10% of our customers, for 10% of my customers, the TAT is being breached? If they start questioning those things, then person who is at the bottom of the line, he or she knows that I will be questioned on it. I better, you know, resolve it within time.
It's interesting because escalation matrices and things like that could be put into place, saying that if somebody doesn't respond, then the next level has to respond, kind of a thing. So it might be fascinating to do. And today, I think it can be automated, right? If a particular person does not respond, can it automatically go to the next level for response? Or do you think those are challenges still?
So one is on the escalation matrix that, okay, if one person is not doing the job correctly, you know, how do you keep escalating? But the second part is that when I'm talking about pods, it is, you know, a group taking the ownership for a certain case, right? That is very, very, very important. You know, that is what every company needs to work on.
All of last year or the last 2 years has been about GenAI. And thanks to GenAI, a lot of chatbots and virtual assistants and all of that experience has got impacted quite significantly, thanks to, you know, generative AI coming into play. What is the impact of chatbots and virtual assistants on the customer experience in recent years?
See, what it actually does is in fact, chatbots and virtual assistants have increased the efficiency to a large extent. So what it does, it helps me to filter out all routine kind of a question which has routine answers, or normal question. What is my order status? Where is my ATM? Things like that, where you don't need a human voice. You don't need a person who can listen to you and, you know, process your query or complaint. So it frees the agents to handle more complex issues, okay, or, you know, which needs an emotional connect with the customer, which needs more analysis to resolve the customer's issue. Okay, so in fact, they have only complemented the overall experience. Somehow there's a myth which says that it'll eat away a lot of jobs, you know, chatbots and virtual assistants will eat away a lot of jobs, which is not the case. Okay, we need humans to solve bigger issues, while the simpler ones can be handled by chatbots and virtual assistants.
So it's very interesting. As a researcher, I'm constantly talking to consumers, right? And one of the challenges that consumers have, so yes, I completely agree that while chatbots have done the job of enhancing productivity from a organization point of view, right? What is the improvement in productivity or efficiency from a consumer experience point of view? Because many, many people will tell you that I go to the chatbot and then I'm ultimately, after 5 minutes of doing some nonsensical chat, I'm pushed on to a customer service experience person, and I've just wasted 5 minutes because the chatbot just doesn't get it. So I'm just trying to understand, how do organizations balance internal productivity and efficiency versus consumer experience and efficiency when you're using new technologies?
See, what has happened over this time is when chatbots started coming in, when people realized that, okay, there's so much of work that you can do in chatbots, they have, misused it to a large extent to say that, okay, ye sab kuch handle kar dega, which is not the case. Okay. You will have to define journeys to say that, okay, this is what the chatbot is capable of. This is what the chatbot will be able to answer, and limit it only to that. You don't have to ensure that everything is being handled by chatbot. I don't think we are using it correctly. It has to be used correctly to say that, okay, mere 10% of the issues are related to status, which I can manage it through chatbot. Or 20% of the cases are such where the customer is only to calling me only to find out, okay, has my IPO allotment happened? So all for all those things, even the customers are not expecting an agent to be there. What they are expecting is just an answer to say that, okay, aapka IPO allotment ho gaya. Or maybe, your order has been executed or it's on the way. That's all the information that the customer wants. He really doesn't want to speak to anyone. But we are not using them, efficiently. We are doing it in a way to minimize cost, which is not the case.
So tell me, if I was an MSME and I was going to start a customer experience piece and I was putting a chatbot or an assistant into place, what kind of things would you advise an MSME to say, hey, listen, do this first and do this next? Is there like a process note that they can operate with? Or is it that these are the fundamentals that you should look at before you kind of, I know it's a long question, but I'm just trying to get a sense of what are the critical things to look at, if I may just ask that.
See, one is that when you're saying that if an MSME has to start, you don't even know what kind of questions that the customer is asking you, right? Now, chatbots and virtual assistants have to be trained. What will you train them on if you don't have a history? Okay, you will not be able to do that. So to start with, you should not be starting with a chatbot or a virtual assistant or something like that. Let the queries come in. Create a knowledge tool first to understand that, okay, what are the type of queries that are coming? What is that the customer is asking me? Now, basis this data, analyze it in a way to say that, okay, these are the questions that an agent has to answer. But these are very simple ones, which I feel that can be handled by a chatbot. You will have to analyze the data to use both these channels effectively. Okay, to start with, I would not suggest that you start with a chatbot, okay, because it's too early for you. And here is where you would actually want to listen to the customer, because you are new. You would want to understand what the customer has to talk about it. You would want to go through each and every call. You would want to go through each and every email to understand that, okay, what is that he's asking me? Where am I failing? What am I not doing correctly? Because only then the customer reaches out to you, right? Otherwise, why would he, if he's happy with something, why will he actually reach out? So just wait, give the process some time, let there be some learning which is there, and then invest into chatbots. Because there's a lot of training that requires to be done for chatbots also. It's not that one question you put in and it will correctly answer, because being Indians, we have a peculiar problem of English also. So while speaking in English, there are a lot of Hindi words that the customer will use, and it is vice versa also. So it could be something like that, right? So you will have to train the chatbots to that extent. And I've actually worked on it extensively for 6 months, so I know what the pain there is. While we feel it is very simple, it needs a lot of work. But it can eventually start minimizing your cost for sure.
So call center first, chatbots later. Just want to understand, when we think about call center management, right? Call center management in itself is extremely challenging. So if an MSME was looking at setting up their own call center, so like you said, don't start a chatbot first, do the call center piece, your things first. What advice would you give MSMEs when setting up call centers and call center management?
A lot of time what happens is, when a customer calls in, every query that the customer calls in for is very unique to a large extent, unless it's something very repetitive, that keeping aside. What happens in agent's life is that there's a lot of information, and all the information is in silos. Okay, you have to ensure that there is a common knowledge tool where all this information is parked, where all the updates are parked in a central, what we call a source of truth has to be there for the agents to refer to. If there is a product update that has come in, it has to be there in the, you know, in a central CRM. Any new change that has happened, any issue that is there, if the customer is asking me an X question, do I have an answer to that? Automate as much as you can, create a common knowledge tool for the agents to refer so that one, between two agents, the answers are the same. Okay, it shouldn't happen that for the same query, there are different kinds of answers. That shouldn't happen because that is how the experiences differ also. So creating a common source of truth is very, very important. Second, there is a lot of backend information which are, as I said, trapped in silos. Okay, if someone comes in and asks me, okay, that what is the interest rate for, you know, since I'm into market, so I'll refer to those things like, you know, what is your interest on MTF? Now, all these information has to be available somewhere. So I'm just coming back that knowledge tool is really, really important. That is the first thing that you start with so that you empower the agents with all the information that they need. Second is that how do you motivate them? Because their jobs are very, very monotonous. Okay, a call center agent has to answer at least 100, approximately 100 calls in a day, you know. It becomes very monotonous, and at the same time, they are on the forefront for any voice that the customer has. They have to go through a lot. How do you ensure that they are motivated to come the next day, start afresh and do it? So a lot of engagement activities need to be done. R&Rs have to be done. You know, you will have to keep mentioning that, okay, you know, this person has received an appreciation today. People standing up and clapping for them. So those kind of engagement activities is something that you'll have to keep doing all the time. Okay, just to ensure that they are motivated enough.
So let's say from a tech point of view, right? When you are setting up a call center, is there backend technology or is there technology that you think is a great way? So, you know, is there technology on which you should set up your call centers? Is there preferred technologies on which to set up your call centers? Are there, you know, large partners with whom you set up call centers? How does one go about doing this entire process?
If you have to really set up a call center, the two basic things that are required for you is one is a good CRM, a CRM which can store all the interactions of the customer, no matter through which channel it has come into. Okay, so that when a customer has called you, maybe he had reached out to you through a chat earlier and now he's calling you. So if you have a CRM which can store all this history, it becomes easier for the customer, for the agent to speak to the customer, because every time the biggest frustration that a customer has is repetition. You know, every time I have to repeat my query, every time I have to, you know, call you up for the same complaint, you know, why do I have to do that? Why can't you check it on yourself? So you need a really, really good CRM which can capture all these issues or all the calls or all the emails that the customer has written to you in a single platform for you to refer, understand that what is going through all these interactions, and then respond to the customer. So that is one. The second is that you need a really, really good dialer. When I'm saying a dialer, which is responsive enough to say that, okay, how many calls are there in a queue? Is it able to give the consumer or the customer the correct wait time to say that, okay, there are three calls in a queue and it could lead to 5 minutes. Would you want a call back? So these are the only two things that you actually need to start with.
Okay. And, you know, you've spoken about both call center and bots, which is when you come into complaints resolution or, you know, I have queries resolution and things like that. You've also spoken to me about through the journey, right? So websites, how much time does it take to load, etc.? How are people interacting with all of this in the last couple of years has become extremely efficient because of the technology that has been coming in, right? Call center efficiency has, like you said, gone up tremendously because we've got better technology today. What are those emerging technologies that you believe will revolutionize digital customer experience in the next few years?
See, there are too much of data is available everywhere now. AIs are capable of indexing and analyzing mountains of data and making decisions simpler for the leaders or the CXOs to use. So that is one area that AIs can really help you. The second is personalization becomes very, very simpler, you know, which the consumers want. So that is on the AI piece. The second piece, you know, which really, really interests me is this new technology, which is the Internet of Things, right? You know, what it has done is it has enabled, devices, home appliances, cars, and much more, and they are all connected. So we can now even, imagining, sitting remotely and closing the door of your house. We had not imagined this ever before. But now there is a technology which is available for you to use. You can switch on your AC remotely. You can preheat your ovens. So that is a very, very interesting thing that has come up. And it will actually revolutionize the way customer experience is, to a very, very large extent. And I'm saying, this is just still the beginning. There's a lot that both these technologies can do, in the future. So definitely looking forward to it.
Great. Rajshree, this has been an absolutely wonderful conversation with you. I know that, all of us are looking forward to new technologies changing the way we interact with each other, we interact with organizations, the way we get served and serviced, right? It's so important as consumers for us to constantly see an improvement in service. And it's equally challenging for organizations to stay on top of the game, because what they are doing is they're really trying to stay ahead of the curve compared with competition, compared with other sectors, etc. So I'm sure that our MSME listeners have learned a lot from you today. And I'm sure that there is a lot more that they can look at when it comes to implementing customer experiences within their own organizations and categories. Thank you so much for your time. And it was absolutely wonderful to have you on the Do Big podcast. Look forward to staying in touch and having you on board once again. Thanks so much, Rajshree, for your time.
Thank you so much, Sheetal. Thanks. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to the Do Big podcast, a podcast that is dedicated to providing insights, strategies, and success stories of smart digital solutions for SMEs. We believe that behind every successful business, there's a strong foundation of reliable and secure technology, be it digital connectivity, cloud infra, cloud apps, collaboration tools, or cybersecurity solutions. In a rapidly evolving digital world where technology is key to progress, Tata Telebusiness Services stands at the forefront of digital transformation of SMEs. Tata Telebusiness Services, with their extensive experience and commitment to empowering businesses, understands the unique needs of SMEs. Whether it's scalable connectivity, robust communication tools, or tailored ICT solutions, Tata Telebusiness Services is here to propel your business forward. Tata Telebusiness Services is synonymous with innovation, reliability, and transformative solutions. So, if you're ready to take your organization to new heights of success, we encourage you to explore the transformative possibilities that Tata Telebusiness Services has to offer. Our contact details are in the description below. Remember, we're available on all major podcast platforms. So if you enjoyed today's conversation, subscribe to our podcast for future episodes, which we promise will be packed with equally valuable insights on questions entrepreneurs face as they digitize and scale businesses with the help of technology. Don't forget to rate and review our podcast, as well as share it with peers, colleagues, and other entrepreneurs like yourself who will benefit from listening to it. Thank you for listening to us. And until the next time, keep embracing technology, and may your business thrive in the digital era.